Let's take a break from physics for a minute. Maybe you need a break. Let's talk about maps. They're pretty cool. And we take for granted that we can just pull out a map of the whole world. But for most of our history, this wasn't the case. If you wanted to figure out where all the land masses on the ocean were, you had to go explore and find them and figure them out so that you could navigate and make the journey that you wanted to make around the globe. Well, now we have to go back to physics, I apologize. It turns out that there are maps for electrons. We call them circuit diagrams. And these circuit diagrams tell us how the electrons move throughout our devices. In this lesson, we're going to begin to understand circuits so that you can think more clearly about how all the electronics around us work. Let's take a look. Let's begin by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll consider how electrons move in metals. Then, we'll introduce the basic components of a circuit. And lastly, we'll practice drawing circuit diagrams. Wires. They're everywhere all around us. Coils of metal surrounded by plastic. What we want to focus on is what happens inside that metal. Well, the inside of the metal looks a bit like this. These red dots represent electrons, and the arrows tell us the directions they're traveling. The electrons inside metal can go where they want. They roam around freely with no particular direction in mind. So in metals, electrons roam freely. We can take advantage of the freedom of these electrons to move, but give them some orientation, some direction, with the battery. So if we hook up wires to a battery, the battery pushes electrons in one particular direction. So batteries provide a force that pushes on electrons. We call this force voltage. It's an electromotive force. So basically just a force that pushes on electrons. So here's our humble battery. And what happens if we put it in a circuit? Well, in a circuit, it will drive electrons through a wire. And in this case, through a light bulb and light up that light bulb. So these electrons, which roam freely in metals, can be forced to go around in a nice orderly circuit by a battery. And when they do that, they do work in the process, like lighting up a light bulb. So moving electrons can do work. Here, the work of lighting a light bulb. Now let's say I want to represent this circuit. And I want to do so with a circuit diagram. How would that work? Now you might ask yourself, why do I really care about a circuit diagram? But remember, this is a very simple circuit. And some circuits get quite complicated, and we need to clearly communicate what's going on in them. So we'll start simple, and we can build to a more complicated circuit diagram. Here, if we represent this as a circuit, we get this guy. All right, now let me go through each part of that. Those little lines there on the left, that's how we represent a battery. And we have a fancy name for a battery inside a circuit diagram. We call it a voltage source. And then we have the light bulb, which is this circle with the cross through it. Now, just a note here, you'll see other different notations for a light bulb, and these are reviewed in your notes, but this is the most common one. So this circuit diagram represents pretty much just a battery and a light bulb, just like we saw before. This circuit diagram is missing one essential thing, and that is an on and off switch. So for example, right now, this light bulb would just stay on all the time. It would be like a flashlight you couldn't turn off. So we need to put in a switch. This is how we represent a switch. In this case, this is a closed switch. That is a switch that is connecting the circuit and letting the light bulb light up. So here we have a switch. We can represent that in a diagram. And when it's open like this, it's off. When it's closed, it's on. So here we would have an open circuit where there would be no light at all. The reason the light would turn off is that to work, circuits must be complete. What does that mean? Well, complete circuits have an uninterrupted path, so you can draw a line all the way through the wire and never lift up your pencil. Here, we have an incomplete circuit. So we need to turn that switch to the on position if we want to run our light bulb. Complete circuits connect those electrons all the way back to the battery so we can go in a nice circuit like this. Now our electrons flow nicely, just as we saw in our beginning diagram, they can flow from the negative side of that battery all the way back to the positive. Why do you think they flow from the negative side? Well, it turns out that's because electrons are negative, they're going to flow from negative to positive. More on that in later lessons. So remember, voltage is an electromotive force. We can provide it with batteries or with a plug in the wall, and it can do all sorts of work. For example, it can toast your bread. That's right, you use electricity to toast your bread. Thanks, electricity. Specifically, in this case, you use what's called a resistor, which converts the electrical energy into heat. So resistors convert electrical energy into heat. How do they do this? They do this by slowing electrons down. So the electrons get moving from your battery, the resistor slows them down, and that friction creates heat. Resistors show up everywhere, so it's not just your humble toaster. Of course, it's in things like space heaters, which also provide warmth with a resistor, but it's also in things like old school light bulbs. This one called an incandescent light bulb produces this light with a resistor. Resistors also show up in microchips. Resistors provide an important tool to be able to adjust the voltage or current in your circuit. Again, topics we'll dive into a little more later. So our toaster is a resistor. How do I represent the circuit that had just a toaster and a battery? Like this. The voltage source over there on the left, which is a battery or just a plug in the wall. And on the right, that squiggly line represents a resistor. All right, now let's practice drawing a circuit diagram. This question says, draw a circuit diagram showing two resistors, a switch, a battery, and a light bulb. Now, it doesn't give us any specific instructions on how to draw this, so there would be many correct answers here. We just need to include the components listed. To remind you what each of these look like, I'm just going to draw them below their name. So first up, resistors. This one actually takes the most practice to draw. We want to start with our wire, and then we're going to go up to a peak. There's going to be six total peaks. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then we'll just go up back to our wire. So that's a resistor. Technically, it has to have those six peaks. Next, a switch. Remember, we're going to have a wire within a bigger circle, and on the other side, we'll have a wire and a big circle as well, and we just need to have a line that goes up on one side that can close to connect that. A battery looks like this, where one side is bigger than the other. And lastly, a light bulb is a circle with an X through it. Of course, you'll see other slight variations on these symbols, but here are the ones we're going to be using in this lesson. So let's go ahead and draw our circuit. I'm just gonna go in order that the problem lists them to make sure I get them all. So draw a circuit diagram showing two resistors. Let's start there. So let's go to our first resistor. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then back to the wire. So there's one resistor, and I'm gonna draw a long wire between them just to make sure it's clear that they're two separate resistors. And now I'll go ahead and once again do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and back up to the wire. Okay, so I'm done with my two resistors. Next, I want a switch. So draw a wire, put a circle, another circle, and a continued wire with a line going up that could close that. Okay, next, a battery. I'm going to turn and go down with my circuit, but you could keep it going straight for now, and that would be fine too. Little side, big side. Cool, and next, a light bulb. I'm gonna draw the light bulb right here, which has a circle and an X. Okay, so there we have it. Now, what might be wrong with that circuit as drawn now? This includes all the parts, but it's not a circuit that's complete. And so the last thing we need to do is just make sure we draw our line all the way back to our starting point. So that's a circuit diagram. It shows two resistors right here and right here, a switch right there, a battery right there, and a light bulb right there. Now it's your turn to practice. Here's a circuit diagram with a battery and two light bulbs. Try drawing a circuit diagram on your sheet of paper, and then I'll show you the correct answer in just a second. Okay, pause it and give it a try. All right, this is what your circuit diagram should look like. It has a battery and then two circles with the crosses on them that represent our light bulbs. What's one improvement you might make to this circuit? If you said a switch, that would be a good idea. Okay, let's review what we've learned. First, we considered how electrons move in metals. We said they're free to roam, and that we can take advantage of these freely moving electrons by adding a battery. We introduced the basic components of a circuit, like a voltage source, a resistor, a light bulb, and a switch. And then we practiced drawing circuit diagrams. Hey, hey.